Today I'm interviewing two-dimensional artist Victoria Pendragon in her beautiful home in the Papa, West Virginia metropolitan area. But she's going to demonstrate one of her processes for, and how would you describe this particular process?
This, I'm using a gel medium.
Yes.
With liquid, what are called fluid acrylics. And what I'm doing is I'm going to just pour it on the canvas and move it around, manipulate it, see what happens. Follow the paint around is what I like to say. So right now, it's going to flow out anyway.
I see it. Yes.
Okay, so what happens, I've decided to do this without... I'm just going to make a little quick swirl through here so the paint colors don't really mix with each other. If I went like that, I would get the
homogeneous
brown and the red.
Then it would be all homogeneous.
Homogeneous, yes. But I don't want it to do that. I want it to do interesting things.
And so the base liquid is a type of gel.
It is. It is simply called gel, I believe. I think it's just a gel.
Okay.
I have like a giant vat of it somewhere I could bring out to show you, but it's just a gel, and it dries transparent. So if you mix color in with it, it will carry the color and be quite a smooth color. But if you don't, if you do what I'm about to do, you'll get transparent areas, and you'll get areas of color. Now sometimes what I do, and maybe I'll do it here just for fun, because, you know, who knows, this could turn out to be interesting. I'm just going to squirt some paint on there so I have a background color behind everything. And I think I will use this iridescent bronze because I've got a gold in there, which could be kind of interesting. So what I'll do is just sort of, I think the word for this actually might be scumble the paint across the canvas just to... in a sense, add interest, because otherwise, every place where it's transparent, it's going to be white. If I move some paint across here, then it'll be a little more interesting in addition to what's going on in the paint.
In the paint that will be mixed with the gel.
In the paint that will be sort of stirred gently.
Into the gel.
Yeah, because I specifically don't want to mix it in. Now
shake, don't stir.
For other things, like the painting of the husky that I'm working on right now, where I have water in the background, I have mixed in quite thoroughly a kind of a teal blue. But for this, what I'm trying to do here, I know that to many people this will just look like stuff on a canvas, but I'm trying to get a sort of a base for a composition. So I'm doing something that I'll want to balance with the other stuff. Okay, so, all right, now we'll do the gentle stuff. Okay, now I'm just gonna pour. And see that all the, that red kind of color came out all in the beginning. If you could get up close, you would see that there's a thin line of the gold in with the red. I have a brown and a red oxide, actually, and a metallic gold. So now, what I'm going to do, and I forgot to put my slow drying stuff in here. There's another medium that you can use that is a slow drying medium, and that gives you a little more fluidity for a longer period of time. What I'm going to do now, and I'll do it so y'all can see, just going to hold it at a slight angle and let it start to run. And you can see that it's making patterns.
Oh yeah, sort of a scalloped snakeskin type pattern.
Mm-hmm. Now those may disappear and they may not. With a technique like this, what I usually do is I'll do this. And then it's going to have to sit and dry for at least 6 hours before I can do something else. Otherwise, all this will run a different direction when I pick it up. So I'm just going to get as much mileage out of this spill as I can, and then I'll come back in later if I like sort of what might be happening here. If I don't, I'll just sand down and paint over it. I did this more as a something as an illustration. Now this is now starting to run into that, which I don't want, so I'm going to go this way a little bit, and all the other drips are now going to change direction and take a little bit of a curve. And this is looking very interesting down here and has potential for becoming a part of something. As a matter of fact, there are a number of very interesting places. This up here is really nice. It's a little thin network of the gold that's going to come over the bronze, because when the stuff that now looks sort of a pale blue, that's the clear. When that dries, that's not going to be pale blue, it's going to be clear. And I love what's happening there. That's a gift. I'll probably have to at least try and do something with it. And what I may do for some areas, like this little area here, that's sort of like a spiral shape, I may very well take the paint with the gel, mix it up, and pour something in there so it goes out and fills the empty spaces. Because upside down, this is looking a little flame-like to me. And it might turn out to be so. Now see, it's not running very much, and I'm going to stop before that one drip hits the bottom. So, oh, that's looking very interesting. Should have done it on the other end. Now I'll have to do something interesting in here. Yeah, that looks very interesting. And with this work, it's very much about serendipity when I work like this. And I don't always work like this, and then sometimes I combine this work with other textured stuff. In this jar is what's called a heavy gel. And you can see that it's kind of, it sits in little points and whatnot. This you can slather on and then kind of, maybe I should put it on here, show you what it does. Palette knife.
It won't. Oh, you mean some places other than where the liquid stuff is?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, the worst that can happen. I'm just going to use my paintbrush because my palette knives are across the room. But I think what I'm going to do is sort of fill in this space down here with this goo. And you can see how gooey it is? It stands up in peaks like whipped cream or something. And I actually like the gray with it. This too comes, when this comes just by itself, it's just clear. Dries white, though. It doesn't dry. The ordinary gel dries clear. This thick stuff dries white. And I put this gray in because of something I'm working on right now. Now I'm going to just drag this off. The hopes that something interesting will occur. Okay. All right, now what I'm going to do is just make textures in that, and the textures will end up, although I rather like what's there. It looks a little wavy. Let's see. If I go like this, I'll get little tiny points. If I could tap it, and they'll stick up. I like that too. I also have a couple very nice sort of comb instruments that make lines through it, and then they'll stay. So you can do anything. I'm very fond of working with texture. Even in my paintings that are not abstract, I like to use a lot of texture. What it does is picks up the light, and you just get a whole different picture from different angles,
mm-hmm.
because of the way the light is hitting the textures, not just the paint. Okay, so that, let me see if I can get that mirror. if I move it around a little in the light, you can actually see a bit of the texture. I don't want to move too much because I don't want to move my pretty things up there. But that's
beautiful.
That's a textured paint. If you want, I can run over to that side of the room and get a painting that's almost completely textured and bring it over and show it to you close
okay,
up.
Okay, sure.
Okay, so this is a very strange piece. It came about in the way that many of my works come about, which is to say that I woke up from sleep and in the state that is referred to as a hypnagogic trance, I saw on, I just saw this background first, just a green textured background. And so I set about creating this flat green textured background with a lighter orangish green center. And then the next morning when I woke up, I saw that I should just go out and take a brush and just basically get it loaded with paint and just go floof across the painting and see what happened. And when I did, this kind of creature looking thing emerged.
Wow, that was not intentional.
No,
from the beginning.
I just floofed it. I don't know how else to say it. I just the brush was loaded with paint, and I ultimately ended up drawing out this to look a little more toe-like, and ultimately put the little shopping bag in his hands, because who doesn't want a little something from the store? So that was painted over the texture. So the first thing I did was put on that, like you saw, I put the gray texture down. This was done with it with no color in it at all. So it was all white, and then I took the paint and painted over that. And then I took that, actually the same bronze that I just used in this painting. This is all one color. It looks like he's black at the top and going into gold, but this is just bronze paint. And when I did it with the brush, it was thicker up here and thinner down here at the end of the stroke. It wasn't a stroke, or how can I say it? What is that, like a fling? So there was more paint at the top, and the bronze on top of the green came up brown, but down here it turned quite a metallic gold. And so this painting, when you move it back and forth in the light, it looks different because the textures catch the light differently, the gold catches the light differently. It's just interesting, simple as it is. This is another piece that is done again with the gel medium. And you can see in this very much a similar effect to what was happening in the piece that I began to create there, which is you can see all the colors flowing. It reminds me of a thing I used to love when I was a kid, which was the oil slicks on water. You know, my father raced cars, and there was always oil all over the driveway. And the rain would come down, and then there would be all these puddles with this ever-changing, you know, rainbows in it. And I was fascinated by it, and I think it's one of the reasons I like working with the color loosely in this way. It's like it's my own little homage to the oil puddles. I call this one Life Fire because it reminded me of fire. And I had every intention of doing an entire canvas covered with the gel. But this, I decided the background here to give it something to pop out against. And when I laid this down, it just looked so perfect. I left it. And I just looked gorgeous. I have no compunction whatsoever about calling my work gorgeous or beautiful or perfect because I really don't have all that much to do with it. I'm just moving the paint around. It's like, oh, that looks good. Stop there. So that's Life Fire. And if you get up close to it, which we really can,
okay, sure.
In that central part, you can see, get up close, you can see how minute the little streams of color are. I mean, they're little tiny streams of blue with yellow, with red, and they're not mixing. In other words, there's no purple in there, there's no green in there. The gel is holding the colors separate from one another, which doesn't always happen. So it's pretty interesting. They also have a map-like quality to me when they're like that. Like the old-fashioned maps, which I love so much, the real ancient maps. You can see, that reminds me of the way that the ground is depicted in some of those. This is called The Beauty When It All Falls Apart. This was a painting. This is actually a painting on top of a painting, but you can, it was a painting I was not entirely satisfied with, and that's these parts that you see through the circles is the other painting, and it was done in a thin gel with flowing colors, and it looked good, but it didn't look good enough. So after it dried, I took to it with a heavier gel on the top of it and used a kind of a thing that you use for decorative painting, like a sponge, and sponged through the heavy gel to remove the paint so that the first painting shows through the second painting. And hence its name, The Beauty When It All Falls Apart. Because the first one was a failure, as far as I was concerned. And I love this, it's one of my favorite pieces. And it is just so indicative of life when we think everything's gone to the dogs and we figure out a way to make it work, it's often better than we could have imagined. So like many of my pieces, it has a secret meaning. So this is a work in progress. It's trying to become a dog. It was a little more cat-like when I started. But it's a Siberian Husky eventually. And this is made with a great deal of that textured paint and the gel paint. And it's part of a series I'm working on now, which is will be a series of 64 paintings based on an ancient Chinese book called the I Ching. And this is Joy, or will be. And this is the textured paint, which I've painted over in the black and the white. This is the gel paint, and this got put on in layers. I painted a background here because what I was trying to do was get the effect of water. And the gel paint is very nice, obviously, you saw from the first time, for getting the feeling of liquid in motion. So what I did was paint in the far distant ocean. And to make the splash, I had to begin with the topmost splash and do the splashing effect on this side, let that dry, do the splashing effect that went this way on top of the head, let that dry, do the one in the center, let that dry. So it's been a series of doing these things and letting them dry. So a lot of, I usually work on at least two paintings at once and often three, just because for this work there's a lot of drying time involved. The gel stuff just takes a long time to dry. I prefer to let it wait a whole day before I paint over it. Now in here, I've put both a teal and a white right in the gel. I mixed the teal thoroughly in. Then I did what you saw me do with the first piece, which was that I dropped the white in so that it just comes out in streams. Sometimes I'll put it down, put the one color down, and drop the liquid paint, the fluid acrylic, right into the gel and then move it, which I did on a lot of parts of this. Then I also have areas where I've put in, you know, droplets and stuff, and that I've done with the brush, or in this case, the bigger ones, with those little foam brushes. So whatever it takes to get it done is what gets it done. This painting has sort of came at the beginning of a lot of unusual work. I talked when I was talking about a painting called A Little Something about waking up with images. And this was, I believe, the first of the paintings that that happened with. And it happened right after a trip we took, about a two and a half week trip out to the Midwest. And we're pretty much submerged in Native American thinking, in the spirituality and all that sort of thing. And I was very much moved by the Crazy Horse Museum and things like that. And we came home, and I think it was like the first or second night after we were home, I had one of those experiences. I woke up from sleep, and my instructions from sleep were to get the big square canvas I had downstairs, so I've always got different shapes of canvases waiting for something, and just to almost literally sort of throw the gel paint on it. And I knew it was going to make big, like a big swath. And I usually work in fairly controllable areas. And I thought, well, that's what I'm getting. And so I went and I threw the big silver paint on it, and then I started moving it around, and then I was like, just throw some white in there. And I threw some white in there, and I moved it all this way, and I moved it all that way, and I moved it all, and finally, I'm going to put a little pink in and a little black in just to bring out some colors. And this was all just happening at one shot, and I'm just moving the paint around the camp. Normally, I talked about doing a piece and a piece and a piece, not on this one. And I let it dry overnight, and in the morning I went out and I looked at it and I thought, darn, there's a horse in there. And I thought, oh, maybe I'm crazy. And my husband came out and he looked at it and he goes, there's a horse in there. I'm like, good. I thought I saw a horse. And you might think that this red thing, I added these as the paint was drying. The red things here, one of which looks like the horse's eye. Yeah, this piece here is hard for me to point, but yeah, I'll try my knuckle. That red, that's red.
Okay, I'll zoom in on that.
And this is red, and that's red.
Okay.
And I just added those. Heaven knows the painting was probably in upside down when I added them, or what was. It didn't even have a direction when I was doing all this. It was all wet. It was all liquid. It was all moving. And I thought, oh, those are cool. And so I drew little tendrils out from them. And so I that was that. And then Robert saw the horse, and I saw the horse, and I thought, that's a horse. And so I called it Born of the Storm, because it looks to me like it's coming out of storm clouds.
So you didn't consciously make the face of the horse?
I did not. If you come up close to this, you can see that you can actually see the drips. Just dripping down there. The only thing I did, I added these little things up here to make it look a little bit like a mane. They're very faint, but they give a little more direction to what was going on up here. And they bring the horse out of the painting. This entire, that's the only, except for these little tendrils that I drew out before I even knew what was going on. that's the only manipulated part of this, except for me sloshing paint around on a canvas. It was pretty amazing. And since then, my work has just been evolving at a crazy rate of speed. And all the animals are coming up now. I never painted an animal before. I would have told you I couldn't paint an animal. But I seem to be able. I mean, heaven knows it's laden with learning experiences, but I'm painting animals, and they look good. So, thanks to the horse born of the storm, brought it through.
This is one of your animal paintings, and could you describe it, please?
Yes. These are zebras. And this painting is part of the series that I'm doing for the I Ching. And the story behind it is one of union, of people coming together in community. And so I wanted to make something with a group of animals coming together. When I thought community, the first thing I thought of were things like bees and wasps and stuff like that. And that was not to me particularly warm and fuzzy. Nothing anybody probably really wanted to look at. So I thought about other animals that lived in herds, like horses and zebras. And then I thought to myself, well, we here on Earth have a bit of a problem with living together. So I think what I'll do is make these zebras all different. And all the different zebras will be living together. And so these are my zebras of many colors, all living together, taking care of each other, looking out for the whole tribe. And that's allegorical of the human tribe, I hope, at some point in time.
Here is collection of 6 of 64 animal paintings.
Proposed.
A proposed 64. Well, we definitely have 6. And the other 58 are proposed. And these were all inspired by the I Ching. So go ahead, Victoria.
Okay. So the elephant on the upper left there is Great strength is what the usual name for that. And when I thought of great strength, I automatically thought of an elephant immediately. I mean, that was just the first thing I thought of. And then when I went online and looked at elephants and elephant pictures and how did I want to do it, and I realized that what I found most poignant was the elephants that had only one tusk, the other probably having been injured, or I don't know if you can steal tusks from a live elephant, I don't think so. I think they have to be dead for that. But it occurred to me that to be such a powerful beast and to be minus one of your instruments of power has got to be something that you learn to contend with. And that's what gives us our strength. It is the things that we lose and the things that challenge us that make us strong. And so I thought this elephant is even stronger than the other elephants and signified to me great strength. That's called conflict. And it's not particularly literal. It's the idea of conflict. You can only see one ram in that. The other one is implied by the additional two horns going the other way. But conflict is almost an inevitable thing in life. The I Ching speaks about the inevitabilities of life and how one handles them. And this is sort of about going in there, getting into the conflict, and making it work. In the case of most animal species that fight for dominance, which is what this is, somebody's got to win. And so that was why I went for the rams, because that was I like their big curling horns, and it's a nice depiction of a necessary conflict, because the reason they're fighting for dominance is it's genetic. They want the strongest genes in the pool. So it's got to happen sometimes. The next one, which is the panther, that doesn't really have to happen sometimes. The original name for this hexagram in the I Ching is called the Marriageable Maiden. And I think the Marriageable Maiden signifies one of the main problems I had with the I Ching, because my culture was so different from the ancient Chinese culture of thousands of years ago, that I couldn't put the idea that this was one of the least favorable of the images that would come up with. And after many, many years of reading the I Ching and not reading it and reading it and not reading it, I finally got the whole thing one morning and realized what this is about. This is ambition. And that's what I call this piece, ambition. And this is that ruthless ambition that says, I will rise. I will do whatever it takes to rise. And I don't care what anybody else thinks. And in this case, it's not necessarily the bride that's rising. The bride was often sold. It was the family that used her to get ahead, which is why it is considered when that hexagram comes up and somebody's reading, it's considered a fairly bad omen. In fact, there's no good part to it. It's like your own family selling you out. And I thought this was an appropriate image for that. It's a fairly vicious thing. Now, yes, I know it's what the beast needs to survive. It's what those families felt they needed to survive too. So that's ambition. The one below it is the beaver gnawing a tree down, is in fact called gnawing through. And I love that one. It is about persistence. It is about, I will get through this. It won't be easy, it won't be short, but I will get through this. And I know all about that in life. So that's an easy one. The next one, the center, so far the only tree I've done. I expect there may be more trees, as I am particularly fond of trees. They carry a great deal of wisdom. And as a child, I learned a great deal from the trees. And this, the name of this is originally called remedying, which is a very old-fashioned term, so I just call it healing. And this old tree, it's a very old tree, and actually this is taken from a photograph that I took when we were out west this summer, outside of Yellowstone somewhere. And that tree has sustained an injury, a grievous injury, and it has healed. It has formed a beautiful open scar there on the edges, and it has healed and goes on to teach. That's what trees do, really. They're teachers. And they, if you think about those old trees out in California, the ones that are just hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years old, there's wisdom in that. And this tree carries the wisdom of being wounded and having healed. I certainly resonate with that, having been quite wounded myself and having had a very bad illness from which I healed, not unlike the way this tree is healing. And the next one is called sacrifice. All these have many different names depending on who's doing the interpretation of the stories. So it's also called loss, but I prefer sacrifice because loss sounds like you're actually losing something to me, when in fact the meaning of it is that you have on purpose put something aside or left it behind so that something else greater can grow from it. That to me is sacrifice. And the father penguin guards the egg for 4 months. Just all it does is stands over the egg for 4 months until mother penguin gets back from the sea, having nourished herself after giving birth and bringing back food. That is sacrifice, and that is sacrifice for, in this case, the tribe of penguins. But we all do this in our lives at some point. We all have to. And so it's very, very relevant. This painting is particularly fun for me because the egg is done in a variety of pearlescent paints, and it's using that technique I use with the gel to whoosh the paint around. So there's metallic in there and pearlescence in there. And in certain lights, it just glows and the colors change. So it's a magical egg. And those are my animals. You want to take a look at the butterfly I have down here just for fun? Yes.
So this is a butterfly, but it's not one of the I Ching, part of the I Ching.
Right. I did a few butterflies prior to all the animals coming through. Just butterflies are a symbol for transformation, and I have often used, if in my collages and things like that, I use butterfly as an image for transformation. And these are sort of fantasy butterflies and not real at all. This one has antlers, for instance. And it's called Above the Storm. You can see an intimation of clouds at the bottom, and the butterfly is rising above the storm with its gifts. Okay. This is called the Night Guardian, and it is inspired by the beautiful lunar moths that one so rarely sees. But they are exquisite, and they are huge, and they are a beautiful creature of the night. And I think, as a child, one is often afraid of the night and the things of the night, sometimes for good reason. And this, to me, it's like a childhood dream of a creature that would protect me at night.
You pointed out the antlers?
Well, yeah. it has the normal antenna that the lunar moth has, which are sort of fascinating things. They look like feathers. And then I, too, added the swoopy gold, what look like giant antlers in this case, just because butterflies need antlers.